And in this crazy life, and through these crazy times, it's you, you make me sing your every line, your every word, your everything, your every song, and I sing along. You're my everything. Good morning, good morning, good morning. How's everybody doing? Welcome to the first ever King's House Marriage Conference. We're so glad you guys are here. My name is Chris. I'm one of the pastors here on staff at the King's House, and this is my beautiful wife, Melody.
Yes, and we have two beautiful kids, Harmony Dawn, who is 4 years old, and Colin Alexander, who is two.
Listen, is anyone else nervous about what's going to happen today? It's okay to be honest, gentlemen. I know some of the men are in the place are like, yes. Listen, I want to take all that out of the room, letting all the air out of the bag. You guys are going to have so much fun today. We're going to laugh. We're going to play some fun games. It's going to be great. I do believe that you're not here by accident. Amen. I really believe that God has you here for a purpose and a reason. And listen, Melody and I have only been married. It'll be 10 years this December. And we are the youngest married couple on staff who's been married the least. So clearly they brought the big guns out first to start the marriage conference with. We know all the answers. But we feel completely unqualified for this. But you know what? God uses the unqualified to bring his glory. And I believe that he's got some stuff he really wants to share with you guys to help strengthen your marriage, not only for yourselves, but for your children, showing them the legacy of what a healthy marriage is supposed to look like, as well as your grandchildren. I do want to make a few quick announcements, though. When we take a break, we've got some stuff going on at KH Central that you guys can purchase, some material that we as pastors feel like can really benefit your marriage, as well as some King's House t-shirts, the marriage t-shirts. We only sold them upon registration. We only wanted to buy the quantities that needed to be provided, but in doing so, our system crashed and we lost a few sizes. So I have to go ahead and reorder some anyway. So if you're thinking today, man, Pastor Chris looks sexy in that shirt, you can too. Only for $15, swing by KH Central, give them your size, they'll fill out a card, you can purchase it, and we will order that for you and let you know when it's in. So let's start this conference off right. Why don't you grab the hand of your spouse and let's open up in a word of prayer. God, we love you so much, and we thank you for marriage. We thank you, God, that you have destined the two who are in this room to become one. God, not just in one flesh by the meanings of sex, but God, you have brought us together to do life together. So, Lord, I pray that today, as we talk about sex, as we talk about communication, as we talk about what makes a marriage work according to your word, I pray that you would bless every single marriage in this room. May it blessedly enrich everything that they're going to do. And as they walk out of these doors, God, they are going to be stepping into a new season of their marriage. In Jesus' name, and everybody says, amen. All right, guys. Turn to the first session in your workbooks.
So we are talking about five love languages this session, and you should have received upon registration an email with a link that led you to a five love language test. If you did not take it, no worries, because it is also in your booklet, so you can go and take it later. But this is what we are particularly talking about right now in this moment, is the five love languages.
The desire for love and romance and marriage is extremely heightened in our media, and it should be, because marriage is serious business. And it's something that we've been talking about as we were getting ready for this marriage conference, that the divorce rate is increasing ever so much. Have you guys noticed that? Tons of marriages, just they're just quitting. And listen, it's worse even in the church world. Christian married couples are calling it quits. So why the divorce epidemic when this whole thing of love and romance is so good? Literally, you guys can take as many notes as you want to today. We encourage that. You can go home and watch as many videos on marriage you want to, read as many books on marriage you want to, and still fail at making your marriage the best it can be. Why? It's not because the material's not good. It's great stuff. It's just that we sometimes fail to implement it in our lives. Am I right? It's hard sometimes. But I want to bring something to you before we talk about the five love languages so you know where we're going with this. We all have a unique way we like to give and receive love. These are called the five love languages. But let me back it up a little bit. My primary speaking language is English, okay? As you can tell, I'm an English speaker. I'm American. But if you ask me what my secondary language would be, I would say I don't really have one, but if I did, it would be a little bit of broken American Sign Language. If you ask me which one I'm more comfortable with, which one would you think I'd be more comfortable with? English, right? You guys got to talk back to me a little bit. It's okay. But if my wife's primary language was sign language, what do you think I would be doing? Yeah, I would be learning sign language, baby. You bet, because that's the only way I'm going to communicate with her, because that's her primary language. The more I use it, the more comfortable I will become using it, and the better I'll become at it. It's the same with our love languages. This is in your notes. It's your first blink, and it'll be on the screen. If we want our spouse to feel the love we're trying to communicate to them, we have to express it in their primary love language, not ours. Their primary love language. This is why studying your spouse is extremely important. What do I mean by studying your spouse? Well, I want to show you a quick video clip, but before I do, let me kind of build up what this video clip's from. It's from a movie called Fireproof. It's kind of an older movie, but it's about fireproofing your marriage. And it was a Christian film that came to theaters in the early 2000s, I think. Maybe 2010, I don't know. It's a great movie. We are selling a few copies today at KH Central if you haven't seen it. But in this video, this marriage is on the rocks. And the wife wants a divorce. He wants a divorce. But somewhere in there, he decides, I kind of want to save this if I can. And so he goes through this thing called The Love Dare, which is also a book we're selling at KH Central today. And it's a 40-day challenge of how he can better himself to love his spouse better. And he's on day 18. And this is what it means to study your spouse. Let's play that video.
So what day are you on?
18.
And?
And it's still difficult. Every day has me adding a new concept to the way I treat her.
For example?
Well, here. Day 16 was about praying for her. I kind of skipped that one. Day 17 is about listening to her. 18's about studying her again.
Studying her?
Yeah, here. And when a man is trying to win the heart of a woman, he studies her. He learns her likes, dislikes, habits, and hobbies. But after he wins her heart and marries her, he often stops learning about her. If the amount he studied her before marriage was equal to a high school degree, he should continue to learn about her until he gains a college degree, a master's degree, and ultimately a doctorate degree. It is a lifelong journey that draws his heart ever closer to hers.
It's a pretty good concept. I never thought about it like that.
So do you study, Tina?
Yeah, but I don't think I got my college degree on her yet. So tell me a little bit more about the studying her.
Yeah, I'm supposed to make her a candlelight dinner and then ask her a whole list of questions.
My advice is go all out.
Meaning?
Don't go cheap. If you don't cook, get it from a good restaurant. Take it home, use your best dishes, glasses, music, everything. Make it a memorable date.
So the point we want to make about studying your spouse is in regards to the emotional love tanks that every single one of us have. So most marriages are compiled of empty love tanks, which is why so many marriages are suffering in some form or fashion. And so,
for example, like the guy could say, what good is all this stuff I provide and I purchase? I bought her a new car. I got her a new house. She wanted those new drapes. I bought all this stuff. And what? She doesn't even tell me thank you or she loves me.
Or a woman might say, he ignores me all day, he treats me not very nice, and then he wants to jump in bed with me, so, like, I really hate this.
Having a healthy relationship in your love languages and knowing whose love language is what and able to communicate with each other in that area really helps those love tanks get filled up. So let's have a little bit of participation in here. If you took the love language test, great. You need to raise your hands on a few of these next questions as we go on this morning. If you did not, like Melody said, it is at the back of this session that you can fill it out. But raise your hand if you did take it and your top love language is number one that we're going to go over, acts of service. Raise your hand. Okay, keep your hands up. Acts of service. Spouses, if your spouse is raising their hand, take note, okay? Because we're about to help you love them better, okay? Acts of service. This is my top one. You guys can put your hands down now. This is my top love language, and this is your first blink in this workbook under acts of service. Write this down. It's that good old phrase, actions speak louder than words for this type. Actions speak louder than words. We're talking about cooking, cleaning, doing the laundry, making sure the car's in working order, mowing the grass, picking up toys, changing the diaper, paying the bills. The list goes on and on and on. All this to say is that when you are doing actions to serve your spouse, it requires planning, it requires thought, it requires time, and it's a good expression of love to your spouse whose primary love language is acts of service. I grew up on a 10-acre farm in good old Midland, Texas, and I learned at a very good age to have a good work ethic and what it means to serve my family by taking care of animals and livestock and just doing anything and everything my dad asked me to do. And I kind of had that just growing up with me in my entire life. And as a person whose top love language is acts of service, I feel absolutely loved and valued when my wife is doing acts of service. For example, if I have a busy day in the office and I come home, I get stressed out and I go completely bonkers if all the toys are in the living room from all the kids. It's the biggest shelf in our house, our floor. And no one, everyone else like that? Biggest, okay. So I come home and it's just chaotic and it's a mess and I'm already stressed. But Melody knows, and out of the time that we've been married together, she knows that one of the ways that she can show love to me is that all these toys are picked up before I come home. Bonus points if the smell of food is cooking in the air or it's already prepared and on the table. Like, but how do I respond to that? I immediately jump in and start serving too, because that's my love language. That's my top love language, and it's also the love language I just naturally give. So I'll start taking out the trash. You cook the meal, so now I'll wash the dishes. But let me pause here really quick and just say to any women who are just giving me, I can feel y'all staring through me right now, I am not that typical stereotype man that says, I'll bring home the bacon, wife, you stay in your place and you cook, you clean, and you do all the housework. That's not me, because this is the point I want to make. Melody does not have to do any of those things. Ladies, you can say amen on that one. It's okay. She doesn't. She's a wonderful stay-at-home mom. She's a wonderful housekeeper, and she's a fantastic organizer, but Melody does not have to do any of that stuff. Now, she does do it because she knows it needs to be done. It's what the house needs to have in order to function properly, but she doesn't have to do any of that stuff, and that's the whole point of the top love language of acts of service, is that love can't be demanded. Did you hear that? Love cannot be demanded. You can request. And things can be done in a requesting way, because if you demand, then it quenches that love for that person. They don't want to serve you if you're demanding stuff. You know what I'm saying? So here's the flip side. And this is in your notes too. Here's the flip side if your spouse is acts of service, okay? This is something to caution you about. Laziness, broken commitments, broken promises, and making more work for them to do are huge no-nos. Okay, if you're wondering how can I love my spouse more, and they raise their hand saying it was acts of service, don't do this part, okay? If you have laziness, broken commitments, and promises, and you make more work for them to do, it's a huge no-no. It just makes us irritable, you know what I'm saying? It makes us upset that we have to come in and do more work. But here's a tip that you can do to help make them feel more loved. Do something you know he or she would like you to do. And bonus points if you do it without them having to ask. Seriously, I feel so loved when I don't have to ask for something to be done, and I'm going to do it, and I'm like, oh, it's already done. Thanks, babe. That's my love language, acts of service.
All right, so raise your hands if your top love language was words of affirmation.
Keep those hands up. Words of affirmation. Spouse,
all right,
take note.
I see
take
you.
Note.
I see you. That's mine, too. Super important. Okay, so on the opposite side of acts of service, there is an old saying, actions speak louder than words, which we just went over. But for us, sometimes words speak louder than actions. Is that right, people who are, yes, words of affirmation? That is so important to us. The Bible says that the tongue has power of life and death. And this rings especially true for those of us who are words of affirmation. So this is in your notes, your first blank for words of affirmation. One way of speaking life and love over your spouse is through encouragement. Encouragement means to inspire courage. So let's say your spouse has untapped potential in them, a calling, a gifting, something that God has for them to fulfill in life, but they don't have the courage to step out in faith and do it. But it might be that very word of encouragement that you as their spouse gives them that confidence to step out and do it. This is so important for words of affirmation, people especially. Also, encouragement requires empathy and seeing the world from your spouse's perspective. It is so important that we pay attention to how our spouse feels and sees things, and that it becomes important to us, and we bring encouragement out of that.
And it's really hard to do that sometimes. To see things through your spouse's perspective, you'll hear more about this later on, but for some of us, we like to fix things. Am I right, gentlemen? Like, that's the problem right there. But they just want you to hear them. They want you to be able to see it through their eyes. It takes work. It's a little difficult, but it's possible.
Okay, so in your notes, the next point right there is another form of words of affirmation is through kind words, and this is all about our tone of voice. So tone of voice. Sometimes our words say one thing, but our tone of voice say something completely different. We're sending double messages when we have the wrong tone of voice with something we're trying to tell our spouse. A soft answer turns away anger. So, you know, it's one thing to be like, hey, I need you to go do that right now. Go do it. Thank you. Or be like, hey, babe, do you mind going and doing that for me? Like, totally different way of saying it. It totally already helps your spouse put down their barriers and want to do that for you, or whatever you're asking or requesting of them. It really helps that. So tone of voice, super important. So let's talk about the flip side of words of affirmation. This is in your notes as well. This would be insults, criticism, demanding words, or sarcasm. These are very hurtful, and they speak death instead of life over your spouse, who is a words of affirmation person. We need to give humble requests of your desires, just like I gave an example of a humble request, asking if he could do something for me in a kind tone voice. It makes a world of difference. Demands belittle your spouse and makes you come across as a tyrant instead of a lover, so it's extremely important that you keep that in mind. And so, for instance, Christopher, my loving, wonderful husband, he was not sarcastic when we first got together. We dated 3 years, and then when we got married, he started working for a church, and a friend of ours at that church that he was around all the time was one of the most sarcastic people we had ever met, him and his wife both. And we hung out with him all the time, and it started rubbing off on my lovely, wonderful spouse here. And it started becoming a multiple times a day thing where he was constantly like jabbing me with sarcastic, funny insults, if that makes sense. Like,
no.
He would try to be funny about
it,
but he'd be jabbing me and like all day long with these sarcastic remarks. And like, it really, really was hurtful. And I had to tell him multiple times for years, guys, years, like, babe, I've told you, sarcasm hurts me. I'm words of affirmation. We learned about this in Bible school. So we've known about the five love languages for our entire relationship. And so we would talk about this often. I'm words of affirmation. You cannot use sarcasm with me.
In my defense, I kept saying, but it wasn't a jab to you. It was just about you. And everyone laughs.
It does not matter to a words of affirmation person. So if your spouse is words
true.
Of affirmation, you need to keep that into perspective. All sarcasm, unless they're very rare and it does not bother them and they find it funny every time, just be aware that all sarcasm is a hit to the heart. So here is a tip if your spouse is words of affirmation. Make it a point to give more truthful compliments. They need to be truthful because we can tell when they're not truthful. More words of affirmation, more encouragement, and kind words every single day. This needs to be your top priority every single day. Do this for your spouse. Find very creative ways to do it. One way that you could do it is just, well, obviously verbally telling your spouse like what you love about them, but even sending text messages throughout the day or writing a note or a card for them to find later, putting it in their I don't know, work bag and letting them find it later. Like, those are so great things that they could find and just be so, like, it just brightens up their day. Even indirect words of affirmation, you complimenting your spouse to a friend or their family member is eventually going to get back to your spouse at some point, and it's only going to, like, double affirm what you said about them and make them feel that more special. Or even complimenting them in front of them to other people, even more so. It just makes them feel so lifted up and loved. So, an example, Christopher and I were dating. We went to go visit his family for a week, and I was staying in his old childhood bedroom, and he was sleeping on the couch in the living room. And he had snuck into the bedroom while I was sleeping and posted from literally floor to ceiling hundreds of papers all over the walls that just said different things he loved about me, things that he admired in me. And when I woke up the next morning, that literally was like he hung the moon, because it was very unexpected. It was very sweet. And yes, it was while we were dating. So a lot of you are thinking, well, that was when you were dating.
Gentlemen, that's free. Write that down. You can take that. It's okay. You're welcome.
But to this day, I will wake up and, like, walk into the living room, and there'll be random days where there's little post-it notes, like, scattered throughout the house waiting for me at the coffee pot or in my bathroom drawer where my toothpaste is. Like, I'll find little random notes here and there, and it literally makes my entire day. Another thing is when he'll randomly send me text messages that just tell me what he loves about me, and it's just out of the blue, nowhere. That literally will leave me in happy tears. It means so much to me. And lastly, one thing we also have been doing since we've been married is we have a journal that we keep, and we'll just pull it out at random times, and whether it's a special occasion or just a regular old day, we'll write a love note to each other in it and, like, leave it for the other person to find. And these are just some examples of things that you can start doing and implementing in your marriage if you have a words of affirmation spouse.
Okay, number three that we're going to go over. Raise your hand if your top love language is physical touch. Raise your hand. Keep your hands up. Keep your hands up. Listen, all of these are gender neutral. Like, words of affirmation does not have to be a female thing. I saw a bunch of guys raise their hands for words of affirmation. Physical touch does not have to be a female thing, male thing. But I do need my wife, who is a female, to explain right now what this actually means, because every red-blooded male in this room is not going to understand what this means, okay? So, gentlemen, listen carefully. Melody, explain physical touch of the love language.
We're meaning non-sexual touch.
See, they didn't even hear that. Say that again.
Non-sexual touch, like holding hands, holding one another, hugging, kissing. We're talking non-sexual, so not leading immediately, no foreplay. We're talking non-sexual.
So the whole point of the person whose love language is physical touch, if you're loving them with their love language of physical touch, the idea, gentlemen, and for some ladies, is not to get sex out of it as a result, okay? Now, sex could be a perk, but don't be going into it being all like, I'm gonna get some tonight.
This is our second love language, and it's pretty high up there, so this is important to us. And when we took the test, we realized, like, you know, we haven't really been, like, loving on each other physically, like, just in normal everyday life. Like, we haven't been doing that as much, and it's still very high up there for both of us. And so we're depleting our love tank unintentionally. And so we've made it a point ever since retaking the test to be like, oh, I'm going to hold your hand. And he's been going, love tank, love tank, love tank, like, just for a joke.
Filling up that love tank, baby. Listen, because there's days where she's super busy, and I want her to know, I'm thinking about you. I want to fill up your love tank. So I'll come in, and I'll just be like, hi, baby, I love you. Good morning. How's your day? Love tank, love tank, love tank, love tank, love tank. She's had to tell me over and over again, like, I'm not a genie in a lamp. Please stop. But it is what it is. It is what it is. Hey, God has uniquely designed the human body. If you've really studied the human body, it's impossible to look at that and say there's no God. Amen? I mean, it is fantastic. Think about your five senses for an example. All of them but one, touch, is limited to only one area of your body. Think about this for a minute. If you need to see, where's it at? Your eyes. Y'all can talk back to me. It's okay. If you need to hear, where's that at? Okay. If you need to smell, where's that at? If you need to taste, where's that at? But if you need to touch, where's that at? All over your body. God has created tiny particles and cells and receptors and all that other mumbo jumbo stuff that I did not go to school for, to where from a very young age, birth even in the womb, you can tell sense of touch what is loving and what is hostile. You can tell what is hot and what is cold. And when you get married, you can tell what's hard and what's soft. You know what I'm saying? But anyway, all that to say, hey, it's a marriage conference. It's a marriage conference. But for this type of physical touch, it can make or break a relationship. It really can. It can communicate that you are loving them or that you're dissatisfied with them. And to the person whose primary love language is physical touch, message is so much far louder than actions or words. They need to feel your touch. This is in your notes, though, because everyone has to understand this. Not all touches are created equal. That's your next blank. Not all touches are created equal. And this is what I mean. Some areas are going to bring more pleasure to your spouse than others. And the only way you're going to learn is with touching your spouse and hearing from them as your instructor. Listen, don't insist on touching your spouse where you want to touch them at when you want to touch them at. Does that make sense? It's kind of hard for us to comprehend, especially if it's your love language of physical touch. We naturally want to give our tough love language that we like to receive. Does that make sense? So again, I'm acts of service. I naturally serve Melody. I naturally serve everybody that I can. It's just who I am. For someone whose top love language is physical touch, they might not want you touching them in certain places at certain times, at certain areas. You know what I'm saying? So we have to learn. You have to be sensitive to your spouse's need and don't make the mistake that where you like to be touched at, how you like to be touched at, and the places you like to be touched at is going to be the same places your spouse likes as well. You have to learn what their needs are, and you have to be sensitive to it. Here's the next thing in your notes. There's two types of love touches that we're going to go over really quick. The first one in your blank is explicit love touches. Now, that's the erotic ones, the about chica, wah, wah. That's the ones we're talking about because it means that you have to have intentionality. It means that it requires your full attention. These are things such as a back rub, some foreplay, you know what I'm saying? But we're talking about the non-sexual, so this is your next blank. We're talking about the implicit love touches. The implicit love touches. These require little time, but it require much thought. And it could be something as small as when you're handing your spouse a cup of coffee in the morning that you brush their hand as you give it to them. You know what I'm saying? Little things like this, the implicit love touches. Listen, once you discover that your spouse's love language, their top one is physical touch, your imagination is the only thing that's keeping you hindered. You know what I'm saying? Like, the creative time gets to come. This is the most easiest one to fix because you're only limited by your imagination. You get to start thinking some areas to touch your spouse on, and I'm not talking sexually again. I know all of us guys immediately go there. We're like, yeah. No, you get to think about, where else can I touch my spouse today where they will feel loved? How else can I touch my spouse today where they feel loved? What about a place? Like, have I held her hand at church? Did I open the door for her and put my hand on her lower back as she stepped up a step? These are things that you can start thinking about to help them. But we got to remember, they have the final word. Look at your spouse and say, you have the final word. That's right. They have the final love. They have the final word in this love touch. Because listen, here's a quick example. I absolutely love, since physical touch is both of our second love language, I absolutely love it when I walk into a room and I know that I'm completely irresistible to my wife. She just can't keep her hands off me. And I walk into a room and she slaps my butt. Like, yeah. Like, and I'm not talking like a little boop. I'm talking like you can hear that spank across the house, you know? But again, I like to receive physical touch, so my like, rawr, like right out of me, I want to be like, yeah, and I'm ready to get that giddy up going in the horse. But so many times throughout this entire marriage that we've been together, every single time I smack my wife on the butt, and it's just as hard or just as loud. She's like, listen, I know you like that, but I don't. I'm all like, yeah, you do. You know you do. She's like, no, I really don't. I'm like, but I like it. She's like, I'll do it to you, but I like doing it to you. She's like, I know you do. Sacrifice. But the whole point is that she likes the little arm around, little rubs, love tank.
That's fine, too.
Listen, we will never touch each other's butts on stage at church again. But this is what it is. It's a marriage conference. But do you see where we're going with this? Just because I like to be smacked on the butt for my wife doesn't mean that she does. She does. She just doesn't know it yet. But anyway, we have to be sensitive to each other's needs. We have to learn how to love each other with their primary love language. Here's the flip side of physical touch. If your spouse's primary love language is physical touch, if you do this, it's danger zone. Neglect and abuse are destructive to your spouse. If you do not touch them, or if you abuse that touching, game over. They do not feel loved. They do not feel validated. But
well,
here's a tip.
This goes for everybody, too. Abuse is, across the board, not okay. But we're specifically just saying, in any case, any little form of abuse or neglect for physical touches.
Absolutely. But here's a tip. If your spouse raised their hand saying, I am a physical touch person, here's a tip for you to love them more, because it doesn't come naturally for you, probably. Place your hand on your loved one's arm while you're talking, maybe while you're walking, or on their lap while you're sitting down together. Put your arm around them, too. It's okay. It's a marriage conference. It's okay. It's gonna be okay.
Okay, so whose love language, their top one, is quality time? Raise your hand.
Keep it up. Spouses, take notes.
Yeah.
Quality time. Quality time.
So this is my third one, but it's still very close to my second one in rank, so it is still very important to me as well. Some of you might have just a top two that are really close, and then you have some bottom ones that just are very low and don't really matter to you. But this one for me is actually really high as well. So quality time people feel the most love when fully engaged and present with each other. You can be with someone and not be with someone. So that TV can be on.
The lights are on, but nobody's home. You know what I'm saying? You're like, uh-huh.
Your phone is in your hand. You are completely distracted by TV, phone, whatever else it may be. And just because you're in the same room with this quality time spouse of yours does not mean that this is fulfilling their love language. They need you to be fully present, completely in it, paying attention to them. We are supposed to give full and undivided attention. Our spending time together is in a common pursuit, communicates that we care about each other and that we enjoy being with each other and that we like to do things together. So in your notes, the first blank for quality time is learning to listen. This is an important factor of quality time. Learning to listen, one, means maintaining eye contact when your spouse is talking, and that keeps your mind from wandering and communicates that he or she has your full attention. Number two, it doesn't, well, hold up, don't listen to your spouse and do something else at the same time. If you need 10 minutes to finish something you're in the middle of, communicate that to your spouse. Tell them, I really want to sit down and listen to you and pay attention and have quality time with you. But if you can give me 10 minutes, I can finish this up and then I'm all yours. That is huge. Communicate that to your spouse so you can give them that 10 minutes or give them that full quality time after your 10 minutes. Number three, ask yourself, what emotion is my spouse experiencing? And when you think you know the answer, ask them. Confirm it with him. Say, hey, so what I'm hearing you say is this, and you felt this. This gives them an opportunity to, one, know that you were paying attention to what they were saying, and two, let's say you kind of misunderstood what they were saying, and they can correct you, and then you all can move on and continue your quality conversation. So that's really important, too. Confirm after you think about what are they saying to me right now, and let them hear that you're listening to them. Four, observe body language, because we all are giving off some sort of body language, and it speaks volumes, so you need to observe body language. And then five, refuse to interrupt them when they're talking. This is extremely hard, especially if your name is Melody. You know, this is just something that I continuously have to work on, because I just think of something, I'm like, oh, and then, yes, it gets bad sometimes. But anyway, so observe body language, and then don't interrupt when they are speaking. So I need you to write this down. It's not in your notes, but I want you to write this part down. We need to create a daily sharing time with our spouse every single day. This is important to communicate and open up your emotions with your spouse. This is all part of quality time. If your spouse has no clue what you're thinking about something that you went through in that day, like you can tell them, hey, so this happened when I was at the office today, and then that's that. Well, that doesn't communicate what you're feeling. We need to learn how to express our emotions to our spouse. This is extremely important, and a lot of people don't know how to do that. And so a tip for y'all is to make a daily sharing time where maybe at the end of the day, you and your spouse are sitting down and you each give three moments of your day and what you are feeling in those moments. And, you know, it doesn't have to be three, but this is just to encourage you to start somewhere. Think of three moments in what you were feeling in that moment, the emotions, how it made you feel, how it made you think, and just everything that it affected you by. Share that with your spouse.
And the best part for us, we've learned, is to do it at the end of the day, like when we're sitting around a dinner table. It took a little while, but for example, Melody bought a brand new pair of pants recently, and she's already lost a little bit more weight. And so she decided to send me a novel of a text one day while I'm at work about this, and I'm thinking to myself, we could be talking about this tonight at dinner time. And so we've had to find out with each other, when do we actually have these quality conversations together? You may be someone who loves to text each other during the day and it doesn't bother you whatsoever, but
hey, that's one of my points, so don't dog it.
I'm not dogging it. You just have to learn which one makes you feel more loved and validated together.
We'll get to that in just a moment.
Yeah, we will.
All right, so next, this is in your notes, quality activity. That's your blank, quality activity. The essential ingredients in a quality activity with your spouse is one, at least one of you wants to do it, two, the other is willing to do it, and three, both of you know why you're doing it, which is to express love by being together. So a personal example for me is I love making memories, and I love going out to eat at restaurants and going and doing things because that is way more important to me than receiving some sort of physical gift. Like for Christmas, gift cards to restaurants make me like the happiest person on earth because I'm like, yes, I get to go to dinner with my spouse or my family and make memories as opposed to something that's going to sit on a shelf. So that is very important to me. Quality time is way more important to me than receiving gifts. And so just think of that for your spouse who that's important to them, or maybe it's still higher up there compared to some other love languages. Keep that in mind. You know, that might be an example of something you can do for your spouse, and it's going to mean way more to them because you put some thought into it and you realize my spouse would rather do a quality activity with me, even if that's going out to eat for dinner, than receiving a trinket of some sort for Christmas or a birthday. So just keep that in mind, that's a way you can do that. So you might ask, where do we find time for such activities and the money, especially if both of us work outside of the home? Like, when do we find time to do this? Well, you make time, because it is like just like you make time for lunch and dinner, it is just as important to your marriage to make time for each other, just as eating lunch and dinner is for your health. Like, it is absolutely essential and necessary that you do this. So why? I already said the why, because it's essential to our marriage. But it might be a little difficult and take some planning, and you might possibly need to give up some individual activities. If you find that you're always going out and doing something on your own or with your friends, and you're not spending time with your spouse at home ever, and especially if they are a quality time person, that's going to be very damaging over time to your spouse. You need to make time. You need to prioritize your spouse and put them first over even going hunting or if it's the woman going shopping or whatever it is. Your spouse is more important than those things. And you may need to do something that you don't particularly enjoy, but it's worth it because then your spouse is going to feel loved and they're going to know that you made an effort to do this with them. So let's go over the flip side of quality time. This is in your notes. Distractions, postponed dates, or the failure to listen, or failure to share your emotions with your spouse can be especially hurtful. Long periods of being apart or spending more time with friends than with your spouse is very damaging. So a tip for those of you who have a quality time spouse, ask what your loved one wants to do with you, and then make it a date without any distractions and have quality conversation with them. Include your spouse throughout the day. Christopher,
I was just including you with a text message, just letting you know how I was feeling in that moment that we spent money. And I already felt like it was a waste of money to have jeans that didn't fit.
Again, in my defense, I'm like, but that could have been some meat
hey.
In our conversation at the dinner table. Like, I really wanted to know that.
It's now become a teasing thing amongst the staff members of all the things the wives like to say to their spouses through text throughout the day. You stinkers. Anyways, so if you are away from your spouse a lot throughout the day, whether you're traveling or you're just gone at work, even sending pictures to your spouse, just including them, just be like, hey, look what
guys,
I'm doing.
Non-sexual pictures.
Non-sexual.
I know where your mind went. You're like, yeah, here's a picture, baby. She's like, put that
like,
away.
Hey, babe, look what I got to do today. And just sending a picture, just for fun. That makes your spouse feel included, feeling like they are there and a part of you and what you're experiencing.
But yes, sex pictures to your spouse is okay.
We're not recommending that necessarily. You can
some
get
people might be
trouble.
Wondering and be like, what? Is that okay?
Or planning a weekend getaway without your kids. This is so important, guys. Like, to make it, even if it's a once-a-year thing for your anniversary or birthday, make it happen at least one time. Save your money to make it happen. If you're in a tight pinch most of the year and you feel like you can't afford a one-night getaway somewhere, you can save some money and make it happen and have family or hire a babysitter or whatever. But that is very important to have just the two of you a getaway. And then also, chores have to be done all the time. Why not do chores together and talk while you're doing it? You're like, you know, doing something and getting it out of the way, but you're getting to enjoy it. It makes it go faster and it's more fun. And then also, you can go for a nice walk in the evening if it's nice weather. Just talk, just the two of you, or even take your kids with you. Like, just whatever you're doing, be intentional about it. You are specifically doing it to spend quality time with one another.
It's good stuff. Okay, last one. Raise your hand if your top love language out of the test was receiving gifts. Anybody receiving gifts? One. Wow. This one is, it's on the last because it's not that it's the least important. It's because it's not as common. Like, it just isn't. So, really, just one in the house receiving gifts? That's okay. Oh, there we go. It could be your secondary language, too. Raise your hand if it came out to be your secondary language. There we go. There we go. A few other hands went up. Okay, cool. All right. Even though this is our last, like I said, it doesn't mean it's any less important, but receiving gifts should not be mistaken for materialism. Did you hear me? Receiving gifts should not be mistaken for materialism. It's not about how much a gift cost. It's about the thought and the intentionality that went into getting it. A gift is something that you can hold and you can say, oh, thanks, babe. Or maybe it is something that is sitting on the shelf and you're having a rough day and you look over and you'd be like, double take, be like, you know, I remember when she got that for me. And it just makes that person's day so much more. You know what? Gift giving actually transcends cultural barriers. Think back about the Pilgrims and the Indians. When they exchanged gifts, what was that? It was friendship. It was welcoming. It was inviting. It was partnership. It was even, it can be love. It's a peace offering. A gift is something that you can hold in your hand, or it could be something like Melody said, it could be a trip to a restaurant or a trip together as a family. The gift itself is not a symbol. It's the thought behind the gift that's a symbol of that love. For example, moms, raise your hand if you remember the first time you were just out and about, maybe in the yard, and your kids are playing, maybe you're talking to a neighbor, I don't know, I'm just painting a picture for you, but you remember that first time your kids randomly came up to you and they gave you a flower from the yard. Everybody remember that? Or in our case, a weed, because we're in McAllister, Oklahoma, okay? Hey, Mom, I got you a flower, and you're like, oh, thanks, sweetheart. You know why? It's because they stopped what they were doing. They stopped playing, you were on their mind, and they picked up a weed or a flower, and they gave it to you as a peace offering because they love you. This is what I'm talking about. Most weddings have the exchanging of rings at their wedding ceremonies. This is a symbol of your love. This is an exchanging of gifts. Think about this for an example. If a spouse had a millionaire that they were married to, and that millionaire gave them a $1 gift every single day for the rest of their marriage, do you think that spouse whose primary love language of receiving gifts would feel loved? Maybe. Probably not. He's a millionaire. You know what I'm saying? Like, really? Think about it for a second. But let's do the flip side. A family who's struggling financially, struggling to pay bills, and someone's top love language or their secondary love language is receiving gifts. If they went to the dollar store and got them a dollar gift that really wasn't in the budget, that $1 gift could speak $1 million worth of love and affirmation to that person. Do you see where I'm going with this? Gifts come in many different shapes, sizes, and colors. Some cost money, and my favorite are free. You get to make them. You know what I'm saying? If you're creative and you get your kids involved. Here's your next blank in the book of receiving gifts. The most important gifts given are ones that require the most thought about your spouse. I'm going to say it again. The most important gifts given are ones that require the most thought about your spouse. If your spouse's primary love language is receiving gifts, don't wait for a special occasion to get them a gift. Don't wait till it's their birthday. Don't wait till it's your anniversary. Give them something throughout the week that tells them, I'm thinking of you, babe. If you are to become an effective gift giver to your spouse whose primary love language is receiving gifts, and listen, for everyone who did not raise their hand, which is 99% of people in this room, it's okay because this is still an important process for us to learn of how we can love our spouse with our gift giving. If we're to be an effective gift giver to our spouse, we have to rethink our finances in our brain. Because if we are that struggling family who's struggling to make ends meet or paying bills or our kids doing this and you don't have enough money to do something for yourself, let alone for your spouse, we have to get out of our mind that we don't have the money, we don't have the money, we don't have the money. You have to get in your mind of, I'm going to invest in my spouse. I'm going to invest in my spouse. I'm going to invest in my spouse. Listen, the Bible is clear to be wise with our money. So if you have a spouse who's just drooling over a $3,000 jewelry gift that she sees in the window, don't go buy the $3,000 jewelry gift in the window if you don't have the money for it. Get them something else that still tells them, I put a lot of thought into this. I made this. I got this for you. To the person whose love language is receiving gift, they will still feel loved and validated just about that. It's not about the item. It's all about how you're communicating love to your spouse. Amen? Because listen, free is my favorite love. I love to give that free gift right there. Here's the flip side, though. If your spouse's primary or secondary language of love is receiving gifts, the flip side is this. Missed birthdays, a missed anniversary, a meaningful date of any kind that you miss is a disaster for those people, and it's also a no-brainer, okay? So if you need to get something as drastic as tattoo those dates on your arm so you can always be like, oh, yeah, my kid was born on such a day, no problem.
Or you could do the practical thing and just put a reminder in your phone that goes off a week ahead of time and be like, oh, I have a week to get a gift.
For all those organizer planner people. Listen, but here's a tip, though. If your spouse's primary love language is receiving gifts, Bill, take note. But this is for everybody. This is really good. Keep a gift idea notebook handy or a note in your phone under notes if you're an Apple person. I don't know what Androids have. But if you're walking with your spouse to the store and they take notice of something like, you know, that looks really great. I'd like to have one of those one day. Put it down in your notes. If you're watching a commercial together and something pops up and she makes a comment like, well, that looks nice. Take a note. And this is for everybody because when you do want to surprise your spouse on a random day with a gift, refer back to your notes. When it is the big special occasions and you're like, I don't know what to get her, refer back to your notes. And if you still don't have those notes, ask their best friends. If you don't know what your spouse really likes, ask their best friends. And dare I mention, you might have to ask your in-laws, okay? If that's the case, if you don't know what it is, you might have to ask them, what is it that they really like? Because remember, you're communicating in their primary love language.
So to conclude today's session of Five Love Languages, we just want to remind y'all that taste buds change every 7 years. People change all the time. When we first took the love language test years ago when we were dating in Bible school, I don't believe acts of service was very high up for you, even though...
I wasn't married, so it was physical touch.
Maybe he wasn't honest with himself when he took the test, but, you know, over the years, it has changed circumstances, and just things became more important to him, and he realized that acts of service is really his thing, so... You just need to realize this is a lifelong study of your spouse. And in your books, we have a graph, and it talks about the different things that you can do in your marriage for your spouse. That, and if there are words of affirmation, quality time, receiving gifts, here's your what.
Here's ways you can communicate to them, actions you can take, and what you need to avoid.
And what to avoid.
Some of you might like deer in a headlight look right now. I can see it in some of the guys' eyes, like, oh my gosh, this is so much information so fast. I feel like I'm in school now. They're telling me I gotta study my spouse. I feel like I got homework. But guess what? Marriage is spelled a W-O-R-K. I'm going to say it again. Marriage is spelled W-O-R-K. And if you ever hear somebody say, my marriage just isn't working out, it's probably because they're not working at their marriage. Can I say that again? If you ever hear someone say, my marriage just isn't working out, it's probably because they're not working at their marriage. Too many times we think of love as a noun, like those butterflies in our stomachs or the goosebumps that we feel whenever we got married. But love's not a noun and not a feeling. It's an action. It's a verb. Too many times we think passively when we should be thinking actively for our spouse. We really need to be studying our spouse and learning what is their top primary love language. How can I go out of my way to do it? And listen, it's not easy. There's days where you do not feel like you want to go lovey-dovey, touchy-touchy, love tank, because the last thing you want is to be touched. But you gotta go into your spouse's primary love language. I wish we could take credit for all of this, but we can't. There's a guy who wrote the book called The Five Love Language. We're selling a few copies out at Kate Central you guys can pick up today. In there, it explains so much more on each of these five love languages of things that you can do to better love your spouse.
And for those of you who feel like you have a very unlovable spouse or that your marriage is extremely one-sided and that you're like, well, this is gonna be pointless because I can love this person all I want to and they're never gonna love me back. Do not lose hope because it will change. As you fill their emotional love tank, it's a natural response for them to start filling your love tank. So we encourage you, get the book because it also talks about if you have an unlovable spouse or a one-sided marriage. There are also other books out there, The Five Love Languages of Your Children, of Your Teenagers, of Your Spouse with PTSD. There's many different topics that you can buy specifically and it might address an issue that you have specifically in your marriage.
Now, we only have a few copies of all of the material that we recommend for the marriage conference, but if we run out, we'll show them on the screen and stuff as we're in our breaks. If we run out of anything, you can still pre-order them through us. The church will buy them. We'll get them shipped here quickly, and we'll contact you as soon as that information's in, as well as the marriage conference t-shirts. Don't forget, if you would like one, you can swing by during our lunch break at Kate Central. You can also pick those up as well. And we have a photo booth for all of our couples that are in here. If you want to take a picture of this year's first King's House Marriage Conference and you want that memory to last forever, go check out our photo booth, not now, not during our break, but during our lunchtime. If you don't want to be the first in line to eat lunch, you can be one of the last after you take the first in line to get a picture taken. Let's do a quick favor. Why don't you grab the hand of your spouse and let's pray, and then we are going to have a short break, and then we're going to get started with the rest of this morning. God, we love you so much, and we thank you that you have uniquely designed each and every one of us with how we want to be loved and how we prefer to give love. And Lord, most of all, we are in this room to state to our spouse that I'm in this with you, babe. I'm in this come hell or high water, no matter what happens. I'm going to devote myself to loving you the way you want to be loved. Lord, yeah, it might feel like work. Yeah, God, it's going to feel like it's school all over again. We're having to study our spouse and take notes. But God, it's a lifelong journey that we are extremely glad to be in together. And we just thank you so much for the person that is holding our hand right now. God, the person that is holding our heart right now. God, that you have divinely put us together. And Lord, what you have put together, let no man separate, and help us to work hard to make this marriage work for your glory in Jesus' name. And everybody says, thank you guys so much. We're going to take a quick break.